why did you feel it was so important to focus on this?
I thought there were so many unexplained aspects of what had happened. It wasn't at all clear whether the attack that happened on the first day was related to the one that happened on the third day. It was, as always, I'm inclined to look into these stories because they're complex events. Right. They are attacks that unfold over several days, and nobody at the end quite knows what happened. And so there's a lot of work to be done unraveling exactly what the order.
And I mean, that's one of the things that was so extraordinary about what began as the attack on Charlie Hebdo. First of all, the fact that it was documented, that so many people had cameras there, as we become used to almost, but that it did go on for day after day after day. I mean, I think I got there that night or the next day, I can't even remember, but it was Friday, I think it was, that it all really ended up with two standoffs in two separate locations. And it's rare that you have an event which is sort of ongoing day after day after day.
Mm. No, it was extraordinary, and also the French authorities at the time had no idea really whether the two attacks, the attackers were related, and so there was this trade-off at the end between, you know, there was a siege outside at the Kosher Deli, and there was also a siege outside the printworks, and the authorities didn't know whether if they went in one first, it would trigger the execution of hostages at, you know, the first location. Mm. So, I mean, this was something that France had never, ever had to deal with before.
In your documentary, too, I mean, you really take us inside this ongoing attack. I mean, it's through the eyes of, you know, survivors, people who witnessed it and were helpless, couldn't do anything to stop it. I mean, you talked to one person who was, I think, in a neighboring building who still has nightmares, believing, I think they said to you that, you know, in their dreams, they save people. They see the attack coming, and they're able to save people. And then when he wakes up, he realizes he didn't save anybody at all.
Yeah. An extraordinary thing for me, as someone who makes documentaries, is that Charlie Hebdo's office was opposite the office of a documentary production company. And so all the people in there were people like me,
wow.
People who film.
I didn't realize that.
Yeah, they film war, they film these kind of events, and that's why they had bulletproof vests in the store cupboard. And that's why some of them were so quick to video, to get their video cameras out and to roll video when the attack was happening. And one of the most affecting scenes in the film is where Martin Boudot, the man whose quote you just mentioned, he starts filming with his iPhone, and they're out on the roof above the Charlie Hebdo office, and you can hear these 11 dull thuds, boom, boom, boom.
Ils sont en train de tirer en bas, là.
And those are execution shots. Those are the one terrorist who's in the conference room executing the journalists down below, and of course this, you know, spread fear amongst the producers and the staff at the production company. They were running around on the roof for a long time, and that's where this feeling came from that they could have gone back down to help because people were bleeding to death at Charlie Hebdo, but they thought there might have been a bomb. They didn't know where the attackers were, so it's this total confusion. And even when you're kind of seasoned, you're a journalist or you're someone who is supposed to be able to keep a cool head in that kind of situation, it's very rare that people can.
I also think it's so important what you're doing, is studying these events so closely, because we know law enforcement does this. I mean, I've talked to people in the NY, you know, New York Police Department, very closely study the Mumbai attack, and they kind of rejigger their training based on Mumbai. Even now, they do active shooter drills based on Mumbai. And with each new attack, they learn new things, just as they did with Charlie Hebdo. And I do think it's important for people, you know, it's very easy to get paralyzed by fear. But when you see your films, as scary as they are, because you're in the midst of this, for me at least, I find them empowering at the same time, because it does sort of allow you to wrap your mind around it and not have it just be this blinding fear, to actually kind of break it down and look at it.
Yeah, it becomes very concrete. It becomes something, as you say, that you can understand and comprehend and actually realize the terrorists are human beings with limited capacities, and that actually, like two of the people that in the film, ordinary citizens can do something. You know, one guy, when the second attacker guns down a policewoman in the street, one of the street cleaners just basically jumps on him and has this incredible wrestling match and is hanging onto the barrel of his Kalashnikov and
right, these are not superhuman people. No. These are petty thugs, petty criminals often,
yeah.
Know very little about religion at all, who have just glommed onto this, and they're not even necessarily, I mean, some have received some training, but, you know, they can be defeated.
Yeah. Yeah, they can, and it's partly the aura of fear that the word terrorist spreads, and it's partly the shock and awe that people experience when a terrorist attack comes out of nowhere in a very familiar setting, like a grocery or an office building. You know, that's what stops us reacting. But if I think what the film shows is when people do react, okay, sometimes it all goes wrong, but oftentimes they're able to influence the outcome.
It's an extraordinary film, and I hope a lot of people see it. Thank you so much.
Thank you.